Joining me now from New York City is Katrina VandenHeuvel, editor and publisher of The Nation. What's your assessment of the Trump administration's reaction to North Korea's launching of that ICBM?
Well, it's incoherent. I mean, one thing that strikes me, Larry, is how so much of our media lives in the eternal present. There's a history to what we're witnessing. And I think the Trump administration would be wise to reflect a little on that history. It's a threat, but 1994 to 2002, the Clinton administration engaged in negotiations to freeze the plutonium program and to buy back medium and long-term missiles. I'm not an expert, but those involved in those negotiations, Robert Gallucci, former Defense Secretary William Perry, believe the only alternative to war, Larry, is negotiations to address the threat we face. And I think it's irresponsible to even talk about war in this situation when you might have thousands and thousands of South Korean civilian casualties. You'd have a region in full chaos, which is what I think motivates China. It's terrified of a region in chaos, a failed state, and what that means. So I think the Trump administration needs to think hard about how it's going to deal with China, which is a great power. I don't know if continuing economic sanctions are the answer. I think a negotiated settlement to deal with this crisis, this threat, and I hope there are wiser, cooler heads in the Trump administration than his Twitter feed might suggest.
Do you negotiate with a madman?
You know, listen, Larry, through time, think about the history of containment and deterrence. The Soviet Union had thousands more missiles. I mean, we've witnessed now, it's a nuclear program. We've now seen perhaps the first launch or two of ICBMs that might reach Hawaii or Alaska. The Soviet Union had thousands of missiles. Containment, deterrence. No one survives in a nuclear exchange. So I think it's very dangerous to go that route. And I do think this is a moment we need to seize. I think North Korea, it's dangerous, but I think one can find a way to negotiate. And you have a new leader in South Korea who was just in Washington at the end of last month, very interesting, who wants to find a way to engage North Korea. The hope is at some point to denuclearize that region, but I don't think that's in the cards. The New York Times this morning concluded with its cover story on North Korea that he may be mad and use Twitter too often and not have enough to do with his time, the leader of North Korea, but he looks out and sees what happened to the Libyan dictator, Muammar Gaddafi, after negotiations with the European Union and the United States. He gave up his nuclear program. Do I need to tell you what happened to him? He was deposed, regime change. We witness a failed state in Libya now. So I think, if I might conclude, the turning point was when George W. Bush came in. The greatest debacle was the Iraq War. The second might have been, and this is according to Robert Gallucci, who was the State Department's lead negotiator in 1994, this axis of evil, calling North Korea a member of the axis of evil and breaking apart the negotiations that were happening under Clinton, may have contributed to where we are today. Instead of continuing those negotiations, we resorted to military approaches, which aren't going to resolve nuclear crises, Larry, unless we all want to be annihilated.
What do you expect from the Trump-Putin meetings?
Well, what do you expect, Larry? I mean, we've seen a country, our country, is, you know, engaged in what might be called Russiagate. There's also Intelgate. I don't even think so much about these two men. I come back to what we were talking about. The Bulletin of Atomic Scientists moved the doomsday clock, which measures sort of the danger of nuclear annihilation, moved it forward a few months ago. When I see these two men meet, I think they better begin to sort out how we're going to deal with an escalating nuclear arms race, which imperils us and the planet. And I think it's just common sense, Larry. Put aside all the theatrics we're going to see about the handshake and how they relate to each other, two strong men. We need a working relationship with Russia to deal with Syria, to resolve that horrific conflict, which is contributing to refugee crisis in Europe. And we need it to deal with the escalating nuclear arms race. We need to resolve the Ukraine-NATO issue. And I think that there should be some movement toward that. It's just common sense. And listen, I've been going to Moscow for 37 years. I understand Putin is an authoritarian leader, but cold wars close down space for dissent. They don't help those on either side who try to speak for transnational human rights. So I think let's hope there's some beginning of more mutual a partnership that contributes to the resolution of those crises.
You wrote a July 4th op-ed in the Washington Post. You called on Americans to consider how one can be patriotic in the Trump era.
Yeah.
Can we be patriotic in any era?
Absolutely. I think the term is contested. I think everyone is a patriot in his or her own right. But my vision of patriotism has less to do with the parades, the military parades, the kind Trump wanted to have a Nationalism Day. It's about upholding, ensuring that our country fulfills its best ideals, fulfills the idea of a more perfect union. And I think in these times when many people feel that the idea of liberty and independence and happiness and security are under threat, whether it's health care politics, the Muslim ban, gutting environmental health, a whole slew of things, that I think, you know, there needs to be a hard thinking about a patriotism that believes that in dissent, in unyielding defense of civil rights and civil liberties, of justice and equality. And I think that is how I see patriotism in the Trump era. And I think it's really extraordinarily important that so many millions are now engaged in the political process. And I think everyone brings to it some piece of them, some history, some family, some community. And that's very exciting. It's not about as much parades and fireworks as really ensuring that Declaration of Independence, which was created in a flawed context, can be built on in generation era after era.
What do you think is going to happen with health care?
I think the Republicans may be committing political suicide one way or the other. It's kind of incoherent. But the idea that you're now going to repeal and not replace shows how a Republican Party that for 7 years, Larry, made repeal and replace a mantra, the centerpiece of their political program, really wasn't doing the work. I mean, it was a lot of talk, no walk. So I think for the Democrats, I think we need to build on the idea that health care is a right. I think you see the beginnings of a fight for Medicare for all, which has more and more support. We need to build that out, lower Medicare's age to 55 maybe, and build it up from below. But I think the rallies also show the Republican Party quite cowardly, running away from citizens who are trying to engage their democratic rights at rallies. I think they'll, you know, so much of the healthcare stuff, Larry, I think you've probably talked about this, is kind of wrapped around a tax cut for the very richest. And that tax cut is important for the next step of the Republican plan, which is a, quote, tax reform. So I don't know how they move forward effectively, but I do think Trump's general priorities haven't really been fulfilled on jobs, on infrastructure, on health care.
Katrina, always great talking with
you. Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Thank you, Larry.